Hey, I'm Jake Lizio, and in this video, I want to give you some information on modulation and changing keys. And the first thing I want to do is just let you know this is not an advanced or complicated or difficult topic. It can actually be very simple. So in this video, what I'm going to do is walk you through a lot of different examples of modulations and key changes that we've heard in popular songs and how they were performed. But most importantly, we're really going to try to hone in on how do these key changes make us feel? Because if we can identify how these tricks make us feel, then as composers, we know when to pull these tricks out of our sleeve and make the listener feel that way. We're going to start pretty simple, and then we'll gradually get more complicated. And what I want to start off with is the most common and simple kind of modulation that we hear, which is just a direct transposition up or down into a new key. And when you transpose something, it just means that you've literally lifted every single note and chord up. So right now I'm playing the Star Spangled Banner in the key of A major. But if I move my fingers up one fret, I'm playing the Star Spangled Banner in the key of A sharp, but you'd call it the key of B flat. If I move my fingers up again, now I'm playing the Star Spangled Banner in the key of B, right? Pretty simple stuff. Moving it up transposes it. Might sound a little awkward on its own, but believe it or not, this is a really common trick to play in modern music. Halfway through your song or near the end, you just dial your song up a half step, and it gives the ending of your song way more energy than where you started off with. And it lets you kind of ride out on a high note as opposed to staying at that same energy level that you started with. A great example of this being done is in Michael Jackson's Man in the Mirror. The choruses there are mainly just G major. It's a G and a G over B, and then a C to a D. Now at the end of that chorus, instead of a D, they play a C sharp diminished, and then a D7 sharp 9, and that pulls you really strongly back to G. And that's just what they do. If you wanna make the world a better place, take a look at yourself, then make a change. However, the second time this chorus comes around, they play this D7 sharp 9, and you expect it to come back to G. But instead, right on the word change, they do the key change and take you to the key of G sharp, which is a half step higher. If you wanna make the world a better place, take a look at yourself and make that change, starting with the man. Now to me, this is like a very comical key change. The effect here is like a surprise birthday party kind of thing. You know, it's totally unexpected. They don't prepare you for it. They give you like a quarter note rest to let you know that something is coming, but to just kind of plop you into a new key like that, I think it's pretty hilarious. And it works. You know, it gives you that energy, it gives you that surprise, and it kind of gives you that, you know, elation throughout the rest of the song. We hear the same trick in Bon Jovi's Living on a Prayer. Those choruses are in the key of E minor. But after the guitar solo, they do an abbreviated pre-chorus, they chop off a beat, and they throw you right into the key of G minor. And this key change is really funny to me too, because you just get sideswiped with it. With that missing beat, it's like you're thrown into the new key before you ever had a chance to anticipate it. And it really adds a nice, you know, vibrant, shining brightness to that last chorus. I use that word brightness a lot with these key changes that move up because we have a tendency to associate higher notes with brightness and lower notes with darkness. So I don't think it's too abstract to say that this really just brightens up the song at the end. Now you don't have to be so abrupt and sudden with these key changes. You can kind of massage them in there a little more subtly. And a great example of this is in Marvin Gaye and Tammy Terrell's Ain't No Mountain High Enough. That song has a pretty complex chord progression, but the choruses can be thought of as B minor. Ain't no mountain high enough. Now after the bridge, they bring in this B-flat major chord, and from there on out, the rest of the song is now a half step higher. Ain't no mountain high enough. And you might miss that key change the first time. It's not totally blatant. It might be obvious to you, but the first time you hear it, it might just kind of slip past you. But you can't really deny that the end of that song has a really great energy that the first half didn't quite have as much of. Now you might be thinking, okay, if you can bump up your song a half step, can you bump up your song a whole step? And the answer is yeah, you can totally do that. Very popular move. A great example is My Girl. That song is in the key of C. My girl, my girl. But by the time it ends, we're in the key of D, which is a whole step higher. And this key change happens in a really great fashion. They don't just plop you in there, they lead you to the key of D through the clever use of some dominant chords. So they use a 1 chord in the key of C, a 4, which is F, back to 1 for C, back to 4 for F. Now the diatonic 2 and the diatonic 5. Now the E major is the 5 of my 6 chord. Instead of playing my diatonic 6, they play a major 6, which is an A major. And that is the dominant chord of D. So it pops us right into the key of D for I've got sunshine. right into the key of D. Lovely modulation, really clear cut, dry example of how to modulate up a whole step. And this is a really popular trope in the 80s. A lot of 80s music does this whole step modulation up. Whitney Houston's I Want to Dance with Somebody, great 80s dance song, is in F sharp major. But about halfway through, they just bump you right up into the key of G sharp major. It's such a potent 80s trick that I used it in my own 80s song, Come Back Home. That song is in the key of B major.
Will you come back home?
But it ends up in the key of C sharp major by bringing in the dominant chord of C sharp right before. And I give you this wild 80s drum fill to kind of ramp up the excitement of that modulation.
Hey, please, will you come back home?
So since we're on the topic of whole steps, I've got to bring up the Metallica transposition. Metallica will take a riff and they'll modulate the whole riff up a major second. So I have a whole step. And then they use that to help them modulate back down. And it's that modulation back down, it's that crash back to earth that gives it that like awesome atom bomb power effect. They do this all over the place. I mean, half of their discography has this change where you move everything up a whole step and then you just come, you know, crashing back to earth. So it's a really nice effect. I've used it a lot in my own songs because it's such a potent little trick and it's easy to perform. So we could keep going all day here. We could do minor thirds and major thirds. I'm just gonna give you a few examples of some of those bigger modulations. I'm the One Who Wants to Be With You is in E major. But at the end, they spice things up by bringing it all the way up a minor third to G major.
I'm the one who wants to be with you.
And maybe the most dramatic and epic modulation that I can think of in modern history is from Celine Dion's My Heart Will Go On. Those choruses are in C sharp minor. After our lovely Titanic flute solo, we end up kind of traveling through some chords, bringing in an F sharp on the bass to take us to F minor. Dramatic modulation, and I think it's because it's such a wide distance away from our original key. But I think it serves another purpose there. We've got a singer that's able to hit these insanely high notes with a lot of control. So as a composer, you want to be able to showcase and highlight your other musicians and your other instruments around you. So to be a composer and say, hey, you know, we can keep our singer in her comfort range for most of the song, but when we really want to turn up the heat, we can bump her up an entire major third so she's singing at the top of her range. That's a good composer's vision for taking a song and lifting it past just the notes on the page. Now you're considering the other musicians, their abilities, and their strengths and weaknesses. So enough about transpositions. Hopefully you get the picture that by turning up a half step or a whole step, you can really increase the brightness on your song. And by doing anything over that, you start getting a little dramatic. But there's a lot of other kind of key changes that we hear on a daily basis. If you ask most music teachers, what should you do for modulations and how should you change keys? Most of them will say, well, take a look at your key and find it on the circle of fifths. Then try to modulate to one of the neighbor keys. Those are keys that only differ by one note. And there's a lot of truth to that, but I don't like approaching modulations from that perspective, and I'll let you know why. First off, that doesn't cover any of the modulations that we just talked about, and those are extremely popular. It also doesn't cover another kind of popular modulation, which is from parallel major to parallel minor. So imagine I'm in the key of A minor, like the George Harrison song, While My Guitar Gently Weeps, with the Beatles. That's in A minor. It borrows a little from A Dorian, but we go from the key of A minor to the key of A major. And that change is really nice. It's got like the sun comes out, right? It's much, it's not like we turned the brightness up. We really went to a whole different environment there. To go from the tonality of this dark A minor and then all of a sudden being in the key of A major, I feel like that's a whole different universe than what we were just talking about just bumping things up. It's like, you know, transplanting to a different place. Now, just as soon as you get to the key of A major, they go through some diatonic chords of A major there, and then they bring you to the dominant chord E, and as you know, the dominant chord can resolve to a major tonic or a minor tonic. So here, they use it to just spin you back into the key of A minor. I look at you. And I love that. Really drastic change from, you know, the storm clouds coming over the horizon, and then all of a sudden the sun comes out and beaming on your face. Really like that modulation. I hear these major minor changes a lot in classical music, too. A lot of the etudes I learned on guitar were pieces that started off in a minor key, but then would end in the same parallel major key. So you start off in E minor, you end in E major. But really, it's not just about parallel major and parallel minor. It's about all of the parallel modes. If you're in the key of C major, it's highly advised to try to move over to C Mixolydian or to C Lydian. And when you do that, take a look at your key signatures and you'll recognize, hey, these are actually neighbor keys to C major. C Mixolydian is the same thing as F major, and C Lydian is the same thing as G major. But when you modulate to the key of F major, I think it's really important to keep your tonal center the same, right? Stick to the tonal center of C, so work modally. Likewise in minor keys, if you want to be in C minor, consider modulating to C Dorian, or consider modulating to C Phrygian. And you might realize, oh, those are actually neighbor keys to my original key signature of C minor. Cool example of this is in another Beatles song, Norwegian Wood, which is in E Mixolydian, or you can think of it as A major. And then all of a sudden they switch to E Dorian.
Asked me to stay and she told me to sit anywhere.
And you might hear that switching from E Mixolydian to E Dorian is less dark than what we did in the last Beatles song where we went from major to minor. Because Dorian's just less dark than minor. So if you've got a good grasp of your modes, then you'll really be prepared to do some cool key changes because you know what kind of environment you're entering when you decide to go into a parallel Lydian or a parallel Aeolian or a parallel Phrygian. So basically, in my experience, it's not too common to just modulate up or down to one of those neighbor keys on the circle of fifths. It's more common to modulate it to a parallel mode, and that will end up being one of those neighbor keys. But I think it's helpful to think of it as a parallel mode. I can't find you one song that does literally just go from the key of C to the key of F. It's 21 Pilots. The song is called House of Gold, and it's pretty clearly in the key of C major.
And when my body turns to stone, will you take care of me?
C is clearly the tonal center there. But then eventually they take you to your four chord.
I will make you queen of everything you see. I'll put you on the map. I'll cure you of disease.
And now we're in the key of F. So, like, that's clearly our tonal center. Now, they have to repeat. They have to get back to the key of C. So they just bring in the C and just start all over again.
She asked me, son, when I grow old.
Which I think is kind of funny. It's like a brute force, but still somewhat elegant method of changing keys. Just change keys. You don't even have to prepare for it. You don't have to massage it in there. You can just do it. And a lot of times, the listener will accept it. Now, we're almost wrapped up here, but I've got to leave you with a little bit more information. First off, if you start changing keys really quickly, you can get even more interesting effects. For example, there's a song by The Supremes called I Hear a Symphony. My dad told me to check this one out when I told him that I was doing a song on modulations, and it's fantastic. First off, the first three chords really play a trick on you for the actual key of the song. Then about halfway through, you get four lightning-fast modulations into different keys, all a half step up. The effect is fantastic. It really allows that song to give it more mileage. You know, it might have gotten stale if you stay in that same key with those same melodies. But by constantly cranking it up half step after half step, you get this constant rush of excitement. It just doesn't let you down. Also, if you do fast key changes from major keys that are unrelated, you can get a really epic God chord effect. I just did this for the commercial I made for my Ultimate Modal poster. The first 40 seconds of that video are these insane chords. They're all major tonalities, but they're all unrelated, and they're constantly shifting. And it just gives you this, like, Genesis of the Cosmos effect, which I really enjoy. Also, I would be remiss to make a video on modulations and not mention John Coltrane's Giant Steps, which is a mess of modulations that are performed very quickly. Also, I want to mention that when you modulate from minor keys to other minor keys, you can get some really creepy haunted house effects. This doesn't happen a lot in popular music, stuff you're going to hear on the radio. There is a song by Toni Braxton, Unbreak My Heart, that is in the key of B minor, and the choruses are in the key of D minor. And that transition is really lovely. I suggest you take a listen to it and listen to the creepiness of that modulation. But when you go from random minor keys to unrelated minor keys, you can get a really spooky effect that you hear a lot in film score. And lastly, one of my favorite popular songs with tons of key changes is Total Eclipse of the Heart. Take a listen to it, figure out the chords, and see if you can string together how those modulations work. So I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope you learned something. If you did enjoy this video, you can thank my awesome and patient Patreon supporters for making it possible. If you want to support me, you can join them at Patreon, or you can consider buying my Ultimate Modal poster that went on sale last week. Thanks for watching, and I will see you next time.